finally, it's time to talk about the ProSiphon Elite. This review, it's been a long time coming, guys. We've broken some world records with this particular unit's prototype, but is the latest tech from IceGiant worth the hype? I've put this production unit through its paces, and today we're going to be talking about the good, the bad, and the ugly. Hey guys, Turk here. I hope you're having a good one. Now, there's been a huge debate amongst PC enthusiasts on what kind of coolers we should be picking for our newest PC builds or upgrades. Sure, the stock AMD cooler gets the job done, and Hyper 212 Evos are a go-to classic. But from there, the number of options is staggering. Over the past 5 to 10 years, all-in-one coolers have run rampant on PC Part Picker for people building PCs, while big air coolers, they've lost their luster due to the size and sex appeal. Sure, both have their places in the market, but where is the innovation? IceGiant wants to change that with their patented ProSiphon technology. Well, the ProSiphon Elite is a massive full coverage cooler that aims to provide water cooling performance without the need for pumps and mechanical parts in their cooler. IceGiant's tech incorporates a two-phase cooling mechanic where the heat from the CPU boils the liquid inside the cooler and forces the vapor to its condenser. From there, a chunky 251 by 120 millimeter radiator facilitates the condenser design to help cool that vapor back into liquid. And with the help of a thing called gravity, the cycle repeats without the need for mechanical pumps. This allows IceGiant to guarantee its function for an impressive 10 years without the need to replace pumps, reservoirs, and tubing like traditional water cooling systems. This technology was impressive with their prototype, which I used to break a few records here on the channel on a hardware bot with our Threadripper. And with their production units, the Elite has slimmed down and dropped down a weight class. They practically shrank the radiator's components depth by half by including 3 condenser cores. With this addition, now we can get a 2 additional fans that can be mounted for optimal performance. Obviously though, guys, this thing is huge. It's not just huge, but it's massive. It's not a big deal for builders who are in a build it and forget it kind of mindset, but if you ever have to remove or replace a fan, you'll be pulling out all the screwdrivers in order to remove the unit. Given the unit's form factor, one must have a chassis that not only can house the beast, but also potentially have enough room for 2 additional fans towards the top in order to improve airflow through your system. Cable management, it can also be a hassle, though creativity and preparation can be a good workaround for that. Though the sheer bulk of the unit, it might steer some of the builders away, this unit definitely has some potential. IceGiant includes all of the mounting hardware for all of today's common sockets, including AMD's AM4 and TRX, and Intel's desktop sockets. Also included are 4 Arctic P12 PST fans, with additional fan splitters to accommodate the influx and connectors. They are rated for 2300 RPM, which is a sizable increase over standard off-the-shelf P12 fans. I'll post a link down in the description for you guys if you want to check out additional information as well as to get your hands on this cooler. With the specs out of the way, let's talk about my testing strategy. For me, I wanted to see just how this cooler will improve my system's performance, as well as verify its overclocking potential. With the ever-growing popularity of AMD's Ryzen chips, let's start our tests off with the Ryzen 9 5900X. The first thing I want to take a look at is if we even need 4 fans on this thing. Let's be honest, 4 fans, it seems a bit excessive, so how do 2, 4, then an additional set of fans for exhaust perform? Starting with a real-world example, blender times don't seem obviously impacted by the increase in fan count, and even engaging PBO loses steam due to the increased run times. Running Assassin's Creed Valhalla, however, does show a subtle improvement in frame rates with the 4-fan solutions. But what happens with a full synthetic load? Now, guys, this is the real reason why this review took so long. When running the system under standard worst-case load with Prime 95, we see expected results from the various ProSiphon Elite configurations. However, when any amount of overclocking is applied to this motherboard, Prime 95 fails to run. After weeks of back and forth with MSI, the MSI MPG Gaming Edge Wi-Fi is not capable of overclocking. Now, Hardware Unboxed has had its own issues with this board in terms of thermals and extreme settings, but I'm shocked to see this board, it won't even run PBO. I've talked with MSI and there are some details to discuss here on our channel. Make sure you hit the subscribe button and the bell icon to make sure you can hear the rest of this story and how MSI plans to make good with their customers. With that out of the way, we can at least confirm that as we increase the number of fans on the unit and the system, we do see cooler temperatures for our CPU T diode measurements. A positive note. But back to IceGiant's original goal. How does this compare to a standard 280mm AIO or even premium air coolers? I've typically tested my AM4 CPUs using a Corsair H110i, so let's see how that stacks up against the two fan and the full fan configuration. Also, let's throw in the popular Noctua NHD15 with a single fan installed. I am surprised that even the two fan configuration works well under standard worst case settings, but besting the IDA 64 temps and landing 2 degrees more than AIO for Prime 95. Unfortunately, VRM temps are impacted due to the huge chunk of metal, but the reduced fan counts compared to the full config are almost worth the 2°C. On the other hand, the Noctua is clearly superior to either configuration, and only the 4 fan plus exhaust setup can surpass its performance. Naturally, I had to test Blender, and what's interesting here is that the AIO, it performs better. Though marginally, each of these results is very close to one another. Cinebench shows similar results, and for equivalent scores, the ProSiphon, it actually needs all 4 fans installed. And a simple benchmark with Valhalla confirms our IDA 64 observations that the 2 fan config is still a decent alternative. However, it doesn't provide the full performance of the IceGiant ProSiphon Elite. But we aren't done here yet, folks. I'm not satisfied with these results. Let's pit the IceGiant against our 2990WX test rig equipped with the Fractal Design S36 AIO. Surely the increased power of the processor will surpass the newest tech from IceGiant. This test bench is rocking the ASUS X399 Zenith Extreme Alpha RTX 3080, and I'm gonna be going back to some good old trusted discs. I'm performing pretty much a mini CPU review here, but we'll be glossing over many of the results while highlighting the cooling solutions deltas. With Shadow of the Tomb Raider, the IceGiant ProSiphon Elite manages to land anywhere between 2 to 3 FPS higher than the Fractal Design AIO. F1 2020 sees a similar delta, though at 1440p, IceGiant goes ahead by 6, and with Red Dead Redemption 2, the ProSiphon beats the AIO by 5 FPS on average. More impressive is the Ashes of the Singularity data. At 1080p, the IceGiant sweeps ahead by 6 to 10 percentage points. Rounding out our graphical workloads, 3D Mark Time Spy squeaks by thanks to a strong GPU score, not the CPU score. This could suggest that the cooling solution increases both the airflow and exhaust from the GPU, which is always a good thing for gamers. However, your chassis might be different and your mileage may vary. But who games on a 2990WX? Switching gears to PC Mark, both coolers trade blows most of the time, with the most meaningful loss for the ProSiphon being from digital content creation benchmarks. That result carries over to Handbrake and both of my Cinebench benchmarks, but Luxmark and POV Ray prefer the beastly cooler. Overall, I'd say both coolers perform well. Now let's push the Zenith Extreme Alpha to the max. I'll be pushing a maximum overclock with Cinebench R20 to hopefully match our world record settings with consecutive executions of multi-core runs. Surprisingly, the IceGiant ProSiphon Elite enables us to push up to 4.1 gigahertz on all 32 cores of our 2990, which is a 2.3% improvement in the Cinebench R20 score. For this overclock, I'm having to supply 1.425 volts through our VRM, resulting in over 100 degrees C temps on the regulators. This condition forces the motherboard to ramp up the VRM fan, which is a clear sign of stress. Guys, the fractal design, it doesn't even come close to this. So it's a clear win for the ProSiphon Elite. With the data in hand, what are my final thoughts on the ProSiphon Elite? First, let's get the ugly out of the way. For most PC builds, this cooler is a love it or hate it design, and its sheer size will be an instant turnoff to some builders. However, I definitely see some industrial themed builds pulling this off very well with some subtle hints of RGB accents, and couple that with the GPU with the pass-through heatsink design, optimal airflow, it can look pretty slick. And for the bad, the performance of this unit might not be worth the price you paid. H115Is can be picked up for around $140, and even premium AIOs cost anywhere between $150 and $200. So is the asking price of $170 MSRP worth it? And if water cooling isn't an option, premium air coolers provide similar performance at a fraction of the cost. Most might lean towards no, but let's talk about the good. In extreme situations, the ProSiphon Elite has superior cooling capacity that neither of these solutions can provide. Coupled with IceGiant's 10-year warranty, this cooler will be performing just as well when, like, the Threadripper 6990X hits shelves. With an AIO, you'll likely be replacing it at least once, and you run the risk of degraded performance as the AIO ages due to algae, corrosion, pump wear, and that sort of thing. And as for the premium air cooler, that's still a decent option, but you likely won't be able to hit the impressive overclocks or prolonged boosting that the IceGiant can deliver. These benefits alone make the ProSiphon Elite an innovative option when it comes to cooling high-performance PCs. Though this first version of their cooler isn't the most aesthetically pleasing, IceGiant's technology has some clear benefits and plenty of use cases where their technology is ideal. I foresee this sort of cooler being implemented in data centers, high-end workstations, and once they actually get the form factor improved a bit, pre-built machines for the masses. And that about covers it for the IceGiant ProSiphon Elite. Did I miss anything, or do I need to cover anything additional for you guys? Let me know down in the comments and I can respond with a post over on our community tab for you guys. As always, I test a lot of this hardware live over at twitch.tv/theturk, and lately we've been comparing some of the ray tracing technologies from AMD and NVIDIA. So if that interests you, go hit me with a follow over there. But that's gonna do it for me today, guys. I hope y'all have a good one. We'll see you next week.